Good morning and a very warm welcome to all who are joining us this morning at Crowthorne Methodist Church to celebrate Pentecost. Our first hymn this morning is Singing the Faith 394, Spirit of God Unseen as the Wind. Our first hymn this morning is Singing the Faith 394, Spirit of God Unseen as the Wind.
Spirit of God Unseen as the Wind, gentleness is the dove. Touch us with love and teach us to sing joy to you, Lord above. Your voice, the sound heard in the wind, o'er fields and hills you sing. Now I can hear the joy in my Lord, the peace your song will bring. With love and teach us to sing joy to you, Lord above. Love in our hearts, praise in our prayers, we follow on your way. Lord of the sky, Lord of the earth, answer us when we pray. Spirit of God unseen as the wind, gentle as is the dove. Touch us with love and teach us to sing joy to you, Lord above.
And now we have our opening prayers. Almighty God, we gather together today as those joined by your Holy Spirit. We come remembering that first Pentecost when your Spirit was given to the apostles, renewing their faith and transforming their lives. We come on this Pentecost Sunday reminded of the constant work of your Spirit, inspiring, guiding, challenging, refining. Almighty God, Spirit of truth, come as you promised and reveal to us more of the way of Christ. Come and fill us with deeper faith and greater love. Give us the gifts we need to work for your kingdom. Inspire us with new vision and purpose and breathe your power into our lives. Open our hearts and minds and souls to your Spirit. And so equip us to live as your people, not just this, but every day, our lives reflecting your glory and proclaiming your love. Holy Spirit, move within us as we pray to the glory of your name. Amen. And our prayers of confession. Living God, forgive us that we can be guilty of not responding gladly to the Spirit's coming, instead of welcoming the Spirit. We greet him with cautious and superstitious hearts, instead of opening our lives to the Spirit's movement. We close our minds to anything which challenges our long-held preconceptions. Instead of gladly receiving your Spirit's gifts, we barricade our souls against change. You warn us to make sure that what we think is the Spirit is indeed of you. Help us when we need to do that. Save us from ever obstructing or frustrating the Spirit. And forgive us all the times we have done that. Open our lives now to your Holy Spirit's life-giving breath so that we may live more truly as your people. Lord, have mercy on us. In the name of Christ, amen. And now we have a sketch which is based on Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 21. God breaks through the language barrier.
The friends of Jesus had a wonderful story to tell. For a time, they thought it was all over. The people who hated Jesus had killed him. But God raised him from the dead and gave him new life. And he'd been seen by all his friends before he went back to heaven. But they had a promise that he'd always be with them. And he told them to tell the whole world the good news that he was alive. And Peter was getting impatient.
So what are we waiting for? We must do as he said, tell the world. And instead, we're all sitting here just praying.
Peter always was the one who went at everything like a bull at a gate. Head down, mouth in gear, and brain in neutral.
Jesus also told us to wait until we got the power we need. I don't know what he meant, but I'm sure we know when we get it.
Andrew knew this was a great festival. There were people from all over the world here, and we've got to tell them so they go back and tell their friends. That's right, isn't it, Andrew?
Fine. And just how we are going to talk to foreign visitors when none of us speak any of their languages?
Peter had to admit Andrew had a point. But before he could answer, something really strange started to happen. It sounded like a gale blowing through the room, but the air was completely still. It grew louder and louder, but still they didn't feel anything.
Didn't Jesus say that God's spirit was like the wind? Didn't he say something about it blowing, and you never knew where it came from or where it went?
Oh, heavens, say this is getting all intellectual.
Peter knew all about nets and fish, but he would never have called himself a deep thinker.
He's right, though. That's exactly what Jesus said, and it's exactly what's happening now.
Never mind the theories, Nathaniel. We've got to get out and do something. On second thoughts, just get out. The room's on fire.
You know, I do believe he's right. The room is on fire. That's very interesting.
Never mind interesting. Let's get out now.
But it's not burning, is it? Lots of fire, but nothing's burning.
He was right. Gradually the panic subsided. But Peter was still agitated.
What's going on? I can't remember anything like this before.
Yes, you can. Moses, the burning bush. It was on fire, but never got burned. Don't you see?
Peter didn't see, but Nathaniel did.
This is the Holy Spirit Jesus promised us. Just like Moses, God's giving us the power we need to go and do his work. Oh, I say, where's everyone gone?
When Nathaniel got outside, he was amazed. Peter was rattling off 19 to the dozen. Nothing strange in that. But he was telling somebody about Jesus in Arabic. Then he heard Andrew speaking in Latin. He'd buttonholed a Roman merchant who just couldn't wait to hear more about Jesus. Just then, a woman came up to Nathaniel.
What's this all about?
I'm really sorry. I don't speak to you Turkish. You'll have to go and ask someone who does.
I don't understand.
Well, it's simple enough. I don't speak your language. Go and ask someone who does.
Well, if you don't speak my language, how come I'm understanding every word you're saying?
She was right. Everyone was amazed. The good news about Jesus was being spread to all the foreign visitors in their own languages.
So this is God's Holy Spirit at work. Very impressive.
Our next hymn is Songs of Fellowship 395, Spirit of the Living God. often have we said something like, I just can't do it, or something similar? If we have, then perhaps we need to pause for a moment and put ourselves alongside those 12 disciples and maybe many others who must have said or thought the same thing after Jesus had left them. But remember how they were transformed in the space of a few moments into people who could do anything. Nothing was beyond them. But there was no secret. You see, the change in them had nothing to do with themselves, but everything to do with God. It took simply the breath of His Spirit to bring about the most astonishing transformation ever. And it set in motion the extraordinary chain of events on what we now call the day of Pentecost. But Pentecost shouldn't only be about one day. It should be about every day. You see, the gift of the Holy Spirit should be a continuous experience intended for us all. You and I, like those who have gone before us, have been called to be Pentecost people, living and working in ways we may have thought beyond us, to the glory of Christ. The question we need to ask ourselves is, have we risen to the challenge? Strange as it may seem, but maybe, just maybe, there's now a new challenge for us. We are waiting to see what God has in mind for us after lockdown. We need to ask God to fill us with His Spirit and to empower us to rise to that new challenge. But I digress. At the time of Pentecost, as it was described in our sketch today, the Jewish people would have been gathering to celebrate their Shavuot, also known as the Festival of Weeks. It was primarily a thanksgiving for the first fruits of the harvest, but also for the giving of the Torah to Moses on Mount Sinai. Both Shavuot and Pentecost are celebrated after a count of 7 weeks, which is why one means weeks and the other means 50. Shavuot is 7 weeks after Passover. Pentecost is 7 weeks, 50 days, well, 49 really, after Easter. Have you ever tried to imagine what the first Pentecost was like? It's one of those Christian festivals that nowadays we talk about as if it were quite run-of-the-mill. But it's far from normal, really, isn't it? I suppose the same can be said for most Christian festivals, actually. A child born to a virgin at Christmas, a man come back from the dead at Easter, ascending to heaven in a cloud, tongues of fire at Pentecost. Try to imagine how you'd have been feeling sitting in that room with the disciples, whose number had grown since Christ's resurrection. The last few weeks must have been confusing. First, they had been part of the wonderful celebrations on Palm Sunday, and they'd seen Jesus overturning the tables in the temple forecourt. Then the people of Jerusalem turned against Jesus and concocted false accusations against him, which led to his crucifixion. And the next thing, they heard that he'd risen from the dead, and he had actually appeared to them and many others after his resurrection. But what's next, they must have thought. They were all gathered together in that room, probably praying, getting ready to celebrate Shavuot, a festival they all knew so well, ready to meet God as they had always done. I wonder if they'd thought about what Jesus had said to them before his ascension. It's not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And this was the moment that God had used to fulfill that promise. Suddenly a wind like a tornado fills the house. Tongues of fire rest on each believer, and they begin speaking uncontrollably in different languages. The people around them thought they were drunk. But no, Peter assured them that all that they were experiencing was the outgoing of the Holy Spirit on the people, as was spoken by the prophet Joel. He said, "And afterward I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my Spirit in those days. I will show wonders in the heavens and on the earth. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." This was God's gift to his people, to the early church. And it's his gift to us today. Each one of us, through our faith in Jesus, has already received the gift of the Holy Spirit. But what have you done with it? You see, the Holy Spirit gives us the gift of a message to tell. Not just any message, the gospel message. One of the central images of Pentecost, as we heard in the sketch, is that the silence was broken and the believers began speaking in tongues. Those who were there heard the gospel message being proclaimed in their own tongue. It was the Holy Spirit who gave the church something new to say. And let's pray it gives us something new to say after lockdown. Friends, the gift of the Holy Spirit is quintessentially a gift, not to the church, but to the whole world. We are energized not so we can be entertained, but so we can fruitfully engage in mission. We are empowered, not so that we can rule over society, but so we can draw people by our example to the cross of Christ. And we are given a voice and a message to proclaim, so that the people around us, and ultimately the whole world, will hear and receive the good news of Jesus Christ. To coin a new phrase, we need an R number way above one. At Crowthorne Methodist Church, we want to be Pentecost Church. We want to know the power of the Holy Spirit among us. And so we must open ourselves to him and ask him to bless us, so that we can be a blessing to the whole community of Crowthorne and beyond. Charles Swindle, an evangelical Christian pastor and author, gave an example of how the Lord must feel as he looks at the way gifts of the Spirit, the body of Christ, have been received and applied by his people. Think how you would feel if this happened to you. Let's say you have a very dear friend who lives far away. Because of the great distance, you haven't been able to see each other for many years. To help close the distance, you buy some special gifts which reflect your love and your care for the friend. These gifts are meant to bring joy to your friend and also to maintain the bond between you. Imagine one day, out of the blue, someone gives you enough money to make a long dreamed of visit to your friend. You travel the many miles and you arrive to a warm welcome. After a while, you have a chance to look around his house, but you see none of your gifts on display. And you begin to search the house. Your heart breaks as eventually you open a cupboard door, only to find the gifts you have sent over the years. They are all unwrapped and unused. Now, my friends, there are many Christians and churches, and maybe sometimes we even count amongst that number, who have done exactly that to the Lord. The Bible says there are different kinds of gifts with the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service with the same Lord. There are different kinds of working with the same God works all of them in all men. It's from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 5 and 6. If we are concerned with the Lord's feelings, then we have to wonder how he feels as he sees his gifts hidden away, unopened and unused. So let's use our gifts. That's our mission, to spread the good news about our Lord Jesus. Our God has equipped us for it by giving us his Holy Spirit. Great peace, great truth, great purpose, great power, and a great message to proclaim. With the Spirit of Pentecost on our side, we can do it. Amen. Now Marjorie is going to lead us in our prayers of intercession.
After each bidding, come, Holy Spirit, you're invited to say, renew the whole creation. On our world and its pain and uncertainty, come, Holy Spirit. Few countries have avoided the C19 infections. Some are denying the state of their infection rate. Other countries are opening their borders without certainty that the situation is safe. Then so many countries are blighted with famine caused by drought or war. We ask that the lessons learned during this period will be continued, so that the world is a safer, less polluted place. Come, Holy Spirit, renew the whole creation. On our nation, our Queen and our government, come, Holy Spirit. Our nation is so divided, not only by those who have and those who have not, but now by those at risk and those taking risks. The Queen isolated and not able to do her job, and the government changing rules daily, playing catch up with the rate of infection and managing or not managing the situation, with media pressure adding to the lack of clarity. Come, Holy Spirit, renew the whole creation. On the city, town or village in which we live, on those who keep us safe at the moment, come, Holy Spirit. We pray for our village and the communities around Crowthorne, where our usual activities are curtailed, and the future things that bring us together, such as the carnival, have been cancelled. We thank those who encouraged setting up the Crowthorne Trail, where our church has been a focal point to remind people of what makes them happy. We also think of those shops and businesses which are still open, the food delivery drivers, the waste collectors and the paper boys, without whom life would be so difficult. And for people that have needed help, the GP surgeries, pharmacies and the local hospital. Come, Holy Spirit, renew the whole creation. On those who have frightened, unwell, alone, and especially those who are in the grip of COVID-19. Come, Holy Spirit. So many of our congregation has been unable to leave their homes for 10 weeks now and must feel so vulnerable, frightened to even open their front door to those who knock. Help us to make contact with friends and neighbours so we can quell their fears and bring cheer to their lonely life. We welcome the times we can connect together by Zoom or congregate in small groups at a distance. We thank you, Lord, for the lives of those who have passed away, confident that they are safely in your embrace. We're grateful that although some people have had the infection, so far, it for most seems to have been mild without lasting effects. Come, Holy Spirit, renew the whole creation. On our church, on other churches we share with, and the church throughout the world, come, Holy Spirit. Lord, we have found new ways of worshipping. Thankful for the skills of our IT and knowledgeable folk, we welcome being able to see and talk to friends from home and away, and to pray and worship together. We value the input from Sharon and our local preachers, who've undertaken such a different way of working. Thanks to people who are able to just transcribe the spoken word to print so it can be shared by others without electronic connection. We pray that learning with electronic resources may make it possible to continue to share worship, even when our church converts from the ether to the physical building once more. We will welcome sharing throughout the circuit and churches together too. Come, Holy Spirit, renew the whole creation. On each of us right now, come, Holy Spirit. Amen. Now we share together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. And deliver us from the evil. For the kingdom, power, and glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen. We sing now our last hymn, Come Down, O Love Divine.
Charity, mine outward vesture.
Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the presence of his glory, to the only wise God our Father, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.
Our first hymn this morning is Singing the Faith 394, Spirit of God Unseen as the Wind.